Everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson, here back with Luis Scott-Vargas. We're here with the top eight of the week for you, and before he says a word, I've got to tell you, it is like pulling teeth sometimes to try to get this guy to figure out lists of things you want to talk about, which seems so easy.
Well, there's a lot of things you can do a top eight about, but they have to be sweet. And nothing sweeter than top eight blue cards, which is our topic for this week.
I think our segment has already morphed. It's no longer top eight anything. It's what's the sweet top eight of the week? And what people have to understand.
The first segment we recorded of the top eight was the top eight sweet standard cards.
Right.
So
I guess we really kind of set the bar at a strange level. Sweet is hard to come by. Sweet is Luis only. But blue cards is something you know a lot about.
It's true. We're trying to figure out, you know, top, like, what are we going to do, top eight of other colors? And, then, you know, like Ojo said, we can do the top eight six green cards. Because, yeah, there's not really, eight of them there. But that's topic for another day. Right now we've got blue cards. And we actually start at number eight with Gifts Ungiven, a card that would probably be at the top of any other color's list in terms of power level. But it barely made eighth here. And that's leaving off a number of good cards. Let's just say blue is deep.
I think you're selling black short when you say
okay,
that.
Okay, black's got some good ones.
All right, because Gifts Ungiven is really like the black DT. In many ways. The blue Demonic Tutor.
Well, what Gifts does, yes. When used correctly, that is what it is. It's one of my favorite cards in the entire game, and part of it is because there's so much going on when you cap Gifts. I mean, to me, the Gifts that automatically win you the game are less interesting than the ones that don't. Because sometimes you have Yawgmoth's Will in your hand, you're like, okay, Gifts for Black Lotus, Ancestral Recall, Dark Ritual, Mox Sapphire. And no matter what they give you, you're just going to go... Psh-sh-sh. But the Gifts where you have to go and get Mox Jet, you know, Demonic Tutor, Time Walk, and Talarian Academy, and what they give you changes how you play the game. Those are the most interesting. Obviously, I'm talking about Vintage here, but, I mean, Gifts also, you know, it dominated Kamigawa Block. It was good in that standard format. But when you cast Gifts, you're playing two games. You're playing what the cards do you want most, and what cards are they going to give you. And you have to balance those. I've done stuff like, get the two cards I want most first, and so they think you're trying to trick them. Because normally when you're pulling out cards, like you just pull out, you know, one by one by one by one. But if you pull out the two cards you want least first, and then the cards you want most, they might think the first two cards you pulled out are the ones you want. Like there's all sorts of ways you can get into your opponent's head. Or you can just shuffle and keep putting the cards on top till you get four, then put them out all at the same time. The fact that these things matter with the card shows how complex the card is.
I mean, I don't know if you remember, we actually did a segment where we talked about like the most skill-intensive cards.
Yeah, and Gifts is definitely one of them. Like I said, there are some Gifts piles where you're going to win the game no matter what. You get Stir the Grave, Hanakami, Soulless Revival, and you know some other arcane spell.
Yeah, he's usually Wear Away, I think.
Wear Away or Cranial Extraction or the stupid Fog card. You know, like. Yeah, those doesn't matter what they give you. Those are the redundant Gifts piles. But sometimes, like I said, you Gifts for the cards that, like, you know, you're playing Tron and you Gifts for two Urza lands and two gas spells and they don't know which ones to give you, you know? Like, you can definitely, like, trick people. I've definitely Gifts for Tron lands I have in my hand because they won't give you the Tron lands and you'll get the cards you actually want. So, Gifts is not only powerful, it's skill intensive, it's fun, all the criteria that makes it on the list.
And that's number eight, by
the way. That's number eight.
We have a long way to go. Seven is the only, one of two counterspells on the list.
Yeah.
Which is surprising because blue is mostly about counterspells when you talk about power.
So we've got Mana Drain here?
Yeah.
And that's
yeah.
Number seven.
Yeah.
A card that's too powerful for Legacy. A card that sees varying amounts of play in Type 1 depending on the season. Right now Spell Pierce is kind of pushing Mana Drain out, but it still sees some play. And, I mean, if you thought counterspell was unfair, I mean, Mana Drain, the card's a joke. Like, you Mana Drain, they're two mana spell, and you get to play, you know, a Factor Fiction or a Tinker for one mana. Like, imagine Mana Draining a Smokestack. I mean, I've done that before. Oh, man.
It's funny, too, as we were reminiscing just recently before we started talking about this segment, and we were like, you know, back in the day, Counterspell was worth more than Mana Drain because, you know, colorless mana, you're going to burn off of it? Like, what are you going to do with it?
Yeah, I mean, you can't burn anymore, which is insane, but even when you did, it didn't matter.
You know, it's like, you'll...
I mean, I've won games off my opponent's mana burning. You're not supposed to... You're not, like, required to remind them, but it still doesn't come up very often. So... I think my favorite play with Mana Drain once is back in the Gifts Mirror, this is a long time ago, in Vintage, my opponent cast his last spell in his hand, it's empty-handed. What I did is I forced it. In response to the forced, I forced my force, and in response to that, I Mana Drained my second force. So his spell got countered by the first force, the force and the drain cancel each other out, then on my turn, I got to play a Darksteel Colossus hardcast because I drained a force. And his spell was much cheaper than force, which is why I needed to drain the force specifically.
Right.
But
right.
It was pretty sweet. I mean, I won that game because of that.
Not good.
Though, to be fair, I probably would have won anyway, but that gave me a two-turn clock as opposed to just sitting there. So
it helps when a whole bunch of people are watching and they want to see you do the coolest thing you possibly can. You're like, oh, yeah?
So going past Mana Drain, what do we got next?
I'm going to remember this whole list. Jace the Mind Sculptor, come on.
Yeah, I mean, a relatively recent card. The newest card on the list by far.
Oh, definitely.
I mean, he's actually the only card, I think Gifts and Jace are the only two somewhat recent cards at all. And Gifts is 5 years older than Jace or whatever. But Jace, I mean, the fact that he's dominating Type 2, doing fairly well in Extended, I wouldn't say dominating exactly, shows up in Legacy, shows up in Type 1, I mean, that's the hallmark of a classically powerful card if there is one. I mean, I'm jamming 4 in my Legacy decks. So yeah, Jace is pretty much everything. I mean, we've talked a lot about Jace, so I don't think we need to go into too much
depth. Yeah, I'm just sitting here like, yeah, still the same
thing. But I mean, when Jace came out, we realized pretty quickly that I'd rather cast Jace than Fax or Gift in Type 1 right now. And that's why my, like, Storm combo decks have Jaces in them. Like, it's just the best thing you can do for 4 mana in Vintage, and that's saying a lot.
It's a huge deal. I mean, I think you can briefly stop on, you know, at what point were you like, okay, well, this is, like, a historically amazing blue card. Not just like, it's really good in Standard right now, it's really good in Block.
It only came out a year ago, but we can still tell it's going to be one of the best blue cards of all time. Which probably shows that they should have dialed it back a bit.
Yeah, whatever. I mean,
that's not debatable, but yeah.
You know what makes the best cards in Standard? Mistakes. Or yeah. Sorry, in Magic, mistakes.
That's true. So next up, we've actually got Tinker.
Another sweet mistake.
Yeah, Tinker, it's done a lot of bad things. It's fetched up, you know, as diverse of targets as, you know, Bosch, Iron Golem, Phyrexian Processor, Mishra's Helix, Phyrexian Colossus. Then the real broken stuff like Darksteel Colossus, Black Lotus, Time Vault, Voltaic Key.
Mindslaver,
Mirror Battlesphere, Inkwell Leviathan, Sundering Titan.
Get greedy with Pentavis.
I mean, it's fetched up a lot of stuff. Yeah, Pentavis. Yeah. It's fetched up probably Tangleware, Smokestack in its day. Like, there are a lot of things you can get with Tinker, and pretty much all of them cost more than 3 mana, as it turns out.
Ah, yeah, ironically enough.
Yeah, so Tinker, still not only number 5 on the list, but yeah, Tinker is pretty insane.
It's pretty obvious, you know? Tutor effect, you know, costs 1 more than Demonic Tutor, but oh, hey, it conveniently puts it into play.
Yeah, saves you 8 mana or 7 mana or 11 mana or now 12 mana. So, yeah.
Moving right on.
Next up is a card that should have been restricted in Type 1 a long time ago.
Wow.
Still got restricted eventually. Currently unrestricted, and the best thing about Legacy, Brainstorm. I mean, there's nothing better than casting Brainstorm, honestly. Like, casting Ancestral is fun, you know, and that may be on the list somewhere, but casting Brainstorm is almost better because Brainstorm not only it's a really skill testing card when you cast it, how you cast it, etc. So anyone can cast Ancestral and win the game, but casting Brainstorm and turning that into a winning position it takes a lot of experience and a lot of practice with Brainstorm, and that's part of the reason it's so awesome. And part of the reason it remained unrestricted in Vintage long past the time when it should have is that not everyone was breaking it as bad as they could have, so it didn't seem like it needed to be restricted, even though I definitely could tell it could have been. Every single deck I had started with 4 Brainstorm. So,
I think that in going to recent past of, you know, your video series, actually, you had it in the Reanimator deck.
Yeah.
And you really were able to showcase to everyone. You're like, you know, this isn't a draw 3, put 2 back, and eventually draw them.
It's an actual draw 3. Like, every deck that plays Brainstorm plays fetch lands. And, I mean, stuff like, when do you turn 1 Brainstorm? Answer, not very often. When do you turn 2 Brainstorm before cracking a fetch? Very often. When do you just save Brainstorm for 3 or 4 turns? When do you immediately throw it out there? It's a lot of stuff that there's no cut and dry rules. It all depends on game state, depends on knowledge of your opponent's deck. Just a really nuanced and awesome card, and obscenely powerful. So
yeah,
everything I want out of a
blue
card.
We haven't even stopped to touch on when, you know, selective hand disruption.
Yeah,
how,
like
how it
when,
works
when
around
do you
that.
When do you protect from Thoughtseize or him? When do you use it to set up counterbalance? Like, it's just
It's a great card, great skill intensive card, one of your favorite cards.
I mean, just like every card on this list is, you know, I'm pretty happy about.
Again, I wish you'd be here for the green list, because it'll be like, someone played that against me once, I think.
Yeah. So next up is...
Top three, let's stop here and say that it, you know, a little contested, a little debate about like what goes where.
Well, the top one was never under contest. The top two, we debated. Ocho and you convinced me that you guys had it right. My initial instinct was to put number 3 card as number 2. Number 3 would be Time Walk. And the fact that it's only top 3, I mean, this is, again, like, I think that, like, the top 6 of these cards beat almost every card on every other list. So it shows that blue may have had a historical bias. It's not just me. It's just the fact that blue cards were just too good.
That's why we're here today. We're not doing a comical list of the top 8 spells that cost 1 red and deal a certain amount of damage to things. Yeah. We're here to be like, you know what? Taking an extra turn for 2 mana is absurd, but it's only the 3rd most absurd thing that a color does.
And Time Walk, I mean, a lot of times it just cycles for 0 mana, which and gives you an extra land drop, so a broken Explore.
Sure.
But sometimes you do stuff like attack them for an extra 11 damage, draw an extra card of Dark Confidant, you know, untap five lands. Like, there's a lot of things you can do with
the
time.
The whole walk. Range is wide.
One of the worst things that you can see in the vintage, like, control mirror is your opponent leading with time walk when they have five or six mana. Because then it's just like, what if I, you know, counter it and all they were going to do is just untap and say go again? What if you don't counter it and then they tap out for Jace? Then you counter Jace, then they untap and cast Yawgmoth's Will. Like, time walk is the ultimate, like, bait card because it's pretty tough to, you know, to deal with. Like, there's just nothing you can do about it. Like, you counter that, then they resolve what they want to resolve, or they were just baiting with it, or you don't counter it and they get to cast two obscene threats and you just can't do anything. So, yeah, it's definitely a walk to remember. But,
huh, interesting. That's all right. That's valid.
Yeah.
Still not as good as the card that just keeps shooting up in value, the one that is the great equalizer forever.
I mean, if you want to play Legacy, you're forced to pick up a bunch of copies of it. Which I imagine you will do soon because the value just keeps going up.
Oh, I will.
Yes. Oh, I will. That, of course, is Force of Will.
There we go.
The glue that holds Vintage and Legacy together to some extent. It stops the ad nauseum decks from just like going and belcher. It, you know, keeps everything honest. I mean, every blue deck plays four. Like, basically, like any deck that's playing over 15 blue cards has four of these because, I mean, it's zero mana, counters anything. I mean, there's nothing much you can say about it. Like,
yeah, helping the Blue Mage lose friends since the mid-90s. That's pretty much Force of Will.
Yeah, I remember when Force of Will came out, it's like, wow, now they can literally counter every spell you've ever played, even if you're on the play. That is stupid. But as it turns out, losing a life and another card is a pretty big cost. I mean, I side out Force of Will fairly often against a lot of decks in Legacy, because Force of Willing, you know, like a Hymn to Turok, is really not that productive. Or Force of Willing a Thoughtseize is even worse. So, for the most part, I don't think you need to assume you have to always play this card. But right now, there's enough dishonest decks in Legacy that you really need them. It's not as good against honest decks that play, you know, real cards, but dishonest decks that try to cast Emrakul for three mana or Ad Nauseam, Force of Will is the card you want to look for.
I think it's a testament to its power level. It's a testament to, like, how it shapes the game that there have been so many variants that are not quite there, but still get plenty of action.
Yeah, like Thwart and Daze and whatnot.
Pact of Negation, all
these
other cards.
I think one of the reasons Force of Will is so awesome is that even though it's like the second best blue card ever printed and, you know, a crucial part of these formats, you never really feel like you're getting destroyed by it. Like, if anyone who's like complaining about Force of Will is trying to do something degenerate. The people who are doing fair things, they don't really care if they get Force Will that much. Your Wild Mikado gets Force Will turn one, it's like, all right, I hymned him for one mana. You know, yeah, when you're casting, you know, Ad Nauseam after sacking Lion's Eye Diamond, sure, but you're trying to kill them on turn one or two. Like, you don't get to complain about it. So it's actually a card that doesn't make you feel terrible when playing against it, unlike some of the other cards on the list, which, you know, are just patently unfair. But it is definitely a card that's worth, you know, it's so important to these formats that I think, you know, it deserves to be on the list.
Definitely. I mean, we could do a whole segment on Force of Will, and we're more or less doing that. Because the last card really doesn't need an introduction. I mean,
I can't recall. What is it exactly?
Good old Ancestral Recall.
Yeah, I mean, aside from Contract from Below, the best card draw spell in the game, but no one plays for Anti. It's a shame. But Ancestral Recall, I mean, one mana, three cards. It's a card that you could quadruple its price, and it would still be slightly unfair. I mean, well, I guess Concentrate's never really unfair, but, I mean, for three mana, it would be unfair, and it costs one mana. Like, that card is just unbelievable. I mean, the fact that you can Merchant Scroll for it and feel good about the bargain you got of three mana for three cards means the card, you know, something wrong with it. So, Ancestral is probably the card you want in your opening hand almost more than anything else in Vintage, even Black Lotus, though it's really close. And the fact that they're, you know, that close means it's pretty hard to argue with Ancestral.
I just think that it's always Ancestral because you can't cast Lotus to get to your Ancestral. More often than not.
It's true, it's true.
But there are a lot of hands where you're like, oh.
I mean, I tried goldfishing, seeing what was better in the opening hand, and assuming your opponent's not doing anything, Lotus is better. But assuming you're playing against a real deck in a real game of Magic, Ancestral is going to end up, I think, winning you more games. So this is a pretty sweet list. I had to say I enjoyed it.
Good luck trying to top it next week. That's all I say. I'm not looking forward to this conversation where Luis and I get together and are like, all right, well, what are we going to do? I don't know.
Before we go, I'd like to mention, you know, some honorable mentions. Factor Fiction definitely got pretty close. That's the biggest one I can think of that I kind of wanted.
I was on the outside looking.
But Gifts, in fact, barely beat it.
It's close. I mean, it's like you. Fact almost seemed too fair, but you got to play it all of Standard. You got to play it all of Extended. They didn't really. I mean, they restricted Invention eventually, but it was with Gifts. It's like in theory, you cast it to win the game.
Yeah, Counterbalance also because it's being so dominant, or not even dominant right now because in Legacy it's on the downswing. But it was insane in Extended for a long time. Saw some play in Type 2, and it's been a perennial competitor in Legacy. So both those cards pretty close. I mean, I'm sure there's more, but those are the two that came to mind.
The list could go on forever. I mean, you could do top 100 blue cards versus top
8. I think next read our top 8 is going to be 9 through 16, the blue cards continued. So
It would stir up a lot from this guy. So
keep sending in your suggestions to magictv@channelfireball.com.
Or tsg@channelfireball.com. And you can always reach Luis.
Yeah, lsv@channelfireball.com.
He's somewhere out there.
Which all my mail gets forwarded to him, and he checks it for me.
Yeah, I know.
Not entirely true.
If you want to know what a Monguise is, I don't know. You can stop sending me that email. You can send it back to this guy.
Well, let's just say if they're a top 8 Monguise list, you'd be on it.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching.